Assalamu alaikum, everybody. I hope whoever is joined in is doing well. My name is Tuba Khalid, and I am part of the psychosocial team in Indus Hospital. The reason why we are here today is to focus on the psychosocial aspect of a hospital setting. Why is it important to have mental health services within a hospital settings? Within a hospital setting, not only for doctors, but also for patients and also for their families. During the treatment process, after the treatment is completed, or, you know, during any chronic diseases. First of all, I would also like to welcome you all to the ICON 2022 conference. And as I said, this session will focus on the importance of how we deal with patients, their families, and doctors during the treatment process, and how we plan everything according to a child's needs, their sensory processes, their sensory needs, and what they require during that treatment process, socially or psychologically as well. We have a great lineup of speakers today who are very experienced and well-versed in this field, starting from Iram Khan, who is not only a psychotherapist, but also is a researcher and is a psychotherapist, an independent researcher, and a trainer. She's played an important role in developing and heading the pediatric psychosocial oncology department at Indus Hospital, along with training healthcare professionals in Aga Khan, Ziauddin, and again Indus Hospital. Our second round of speakers will be Dion Sears and Tara Farley. Dion and Tara are both part of the Sidra Medicine Hospital, where they serve as licensed clinical social workers and have experience in master's in their social work. Dion is the supervisor of social work in Sidra Medicine. She is a licensed clinical social worker with 15 years of clinical and 7 years of leadership experience. And Tara Farley is a senior clinical social worker at Sidra Medicine for the past 4 years. She has been practicing for 12 years, specializing in child protection, domestic violence, and medical social work. Our last speaker of this session will be Katie Taylor. She is a certified child life specialist, a CEO, and founder of Child Life On Call. Katie graduated from the Pennsylvania State University. She is a certified child life specialist, founder of Child Life On Call. She authored her first children's book, Super Silly Wash Your Hands Dance. And when she's not doing all things Child Life On Call, she is busy helping hundreds of families navigate challenging life events. So I would really like to welcome Iram Khan to talk about what it is to provide mental health services to doctors.
Assalamu alaikum. Mera naam Iram Khan hai. I'm a clinical psychologist. And today I'll be talking about mental health in a healthcare setting, no one left behind, for healthcare workers. जब हम हेल्थ केयर वर्कर्स की बात करते हैं तो इट्स वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टू रिमेंबर कि हेल्थ केयर वर्कर्स जो हैं वो सिर्फ डॉक्टर्स एंड नर्सेज नहीं बट ऑल दोस पीपल हु हैव बीन एजुकेटेड एंड ट्रेन्ड एंड आर क्वालिफाइड टू प्रोवाइड हेल्थ केयर सर्विसेज टू पेशेंट्स एंड दीज कुड बी एनेस्थीजियोलॉजिस्ट्स दीज कुड बी फिजियोथेरेपिस्ट्स दीज कुड बी मेंटल हेल्थ काउंसलर्स टू नेम अ फ्यू अब हम अपने एजेंडा की तरफ चलते हैं फॉर टुडेज सेशन And it is identifying mental health issues, research on healthcare workers' mental health, burnout and its causes and symptoms, clinician well-being and resilience, and self-compassion, which is one of the most important things that you can do for yourself. जब हम mental health issues की identification की बात करते हैं, तो जो तीन factor stand out in all these five issues are physical, emotional, and behavioral issues that will come up in depression, anxiety, compassion fatigue, moral distress, and burnout. Depression ka humne bahut suna hua hai, anxiety ka bhi humne bahut suna hua hai. So I'm just going to touch upon them. Depression is consistently low mood, anxiety ek ghabraha. Depression mein humein hum sochte hai pichla, regret, resentment, bitterness, past ke baare mein. Anxiety is usually about the future. Ke kya hoga, kis tarah hoga, kaise hoga. Compassion fatigue is a result of vicarious or secondary traumatic stress. Vicarious trauma is when we have direct exposure to the patient's distress or injury. Secondary trauma is when we are hearing the patient's account of their distress or trauma or injury. जब आप किसी के साथ बैठते हैं वो रोता है या परेशानी की बात बताता है चाहे आपका दोस्त हो चाहे कोई भी हो तो आप पे असर पड़ता है. तो ये याद रखिए कि as healthcare workers आप डे इन एंड डे आउट ये कहानियां सुन रहे होते हैं. और जैसे हम कहते हैं कि पत्थर पे भी अगर टिप टिप पानी गिरे तो वो जिसे कहते हैं ना उस पे एक चोट लगना शुरू हो जाती है तो हम तो फिर भी इंसान हैं. मॉरल डिस्ट्रेस का जहां ताल्लुक है इट इज व्हेन हमारे वैल्यू सिस्टम के बरखिलाफ हम कोई डिसीजन लें तो सिटिंग विद दैट कैन बी वेरी डिफिकल्ट एट टाइम्स. दैट्स व्हाई इट्स वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टू हैव एथिक्स कमिटीज एंड आपके मेंटरशिप टू हेल्प ईज दैट प्रोसेस एंड सपोर्ट ग्रुप्स. इसमें जो है ऐसी कोई डिसीजन जैसे कि वेंट एक है और पेशेंट्स दो हैं तो आप किसको वेंट देंगे राइट. That becomes problematic and that's a heavy decision to make. And you should not be the only one bearing the burden of that decision. And burnout ko umuman main kehti hu, the big daddy of them all. Ke in sab ka nichod jo hai, jab chronic ho jati hai cheezein, to burnout ki taraf hume le jate. And burnout itself can lead to depression and anxiety, khas taur pe jab depression and anxiety pehle nahi tha. जहां तक रिसर्च का सवाल है अगर आप देखें मूड एंड स्लीप डिसऑर्डर्स के हम परसेंटेजेस की जो बात कर रहे हैं हम 1% और 2% नहीं बट दीज आर क्वाइट हाई नंबर्स. दे शुडंट दीज नंबर्स शुडंट बी दिस हाई स्पेशली व्हेन वी हैव गुड सिस्टम्स इन प्लेस देन इट वुडंट रीच टू दिस पॉइंट. अगर देखें आप तो इधर स्लीप डिसऑर्डर्स आर क्वाइट हाई, हाइपरसोमनिया, इनसोमनिया, नींद में परेशानी, सोना मुश्किल से होना पूरा होना या नींद पूरी होनी, आप रिफ्रेश नहीं उठते, आप परेशान उठते हैं, आप सोते वक्त टॉसिंग एंड टर्निंग and nightmares as well. And healthcare workers usually tend to hide their difficulties due to the stigmas attached. So individual level pe aur system ke level pe hame jo hai, we need to move beyond stigma with regard to mental health issues and our distress. Mazaak nahi udana and sunna and validating. Moral distress, agar aap dekhi, ke 52.7% to 87.8% endorse moral distress. And inke teen dimensions jo hain wo numaya hue hain ki negative impact on family ke mere kaam se meri family pe kya asar pad raha hai, fear of infecting others and work related concerns. Vicarious or secondary trauma, interestingly vicarious trauma was higher in non front healthline workers as compared to frontline because frontline workers pe bahut focus kiya gaya hai. नॉन फ्रंटलाइन वर्कर्स जिसे हम कहते हैं ना घर की मुर्गी दाल बराबर, वो तो सदियों से करते आ रहे हैं, करते रहेंगे, तो हम इतना फोकस नहीं करते जितना हमें करना चाहिए. एंड इट इज टाइम टू डू दैट. जहां सेकेंडरी ट्रॉमेटिक स्ट्रेस है यू विल नोटिस कि देयर इज इमेंस अमाउंट्स ऑफ इमोशनल एग्जॉस्शन एंड अ कंसिडरेबल प्रोपोर्शन ऑफ HCWs हैड दैट एंड डीपर्सनलाइजेशन. जहां हमारा अपने आप से और क्लाइंट या पेशेंट से ताल्लुक जो है वो टूट जाता है, जहां हम फील नहीं कर पाते, एम्पथी नहीं दे पाते ना अपने आप को ना दूसरे को. जहां बर्नआउट अमंग हेल्थ वर्कर्स का ताल्लुक है सो यू विल सी के देयर वाज अगेन अ हाई रेट ऑफ बर्नआउट फ्रॉम 35.1% इन वन रिसर्च टू 80.5% एंड देन मोस्टली वेमेन, ब्लैक एंड लेटिनो इंडिविजुअल्स, हॉस्पिटल वर्कर्स. ये US हेल्थ ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस की बात कर रही हूँ एंड नर्सिंग असिस्टेंट्स, मेडिकल असिस्टेंट्स एंड सोशल वर्कर्स. एंड सोशल वर्कर्स आर इंटेग्रल पार्ट ऑफ द हेल्थ केयर सिस्टम एज वेल. स्ट्रेस एंड बर्नआउट ऑल्सो वर एसोसिएटेड विद फियर ऑफ एक्सपोजर, सेल्फ रिपोर्टेड एंजाइटी, डिप्रेशन एंड वर्क ओवरलोड. सो वर्क ओवरलोड जो है इज समथिंग दैट वी कैन एज एन इंस्टीट्यूशन ऑल्सो लुक एट कि किस तरह हम अपनी एम्प्लॉयज, अपनी वर्कर्स की जिंदगी आसान कर सकें, अपने स्टाफ की जिंदगी आसान कर सकें. अब जहां तक HCWs इन पाकिस्तान का सवाल है, 12% had moderate to severe level of depression and 45.4% had mild level. Mild level भी क्यों हो? That's a big percentage. And anxiety was quite high, at 33.3% moderate to severe levels of anxiety. And anxiety can be very debilitating. It can really wreak havoc on our systems, on our relationships, our relationship apne saath, our relationship dusron ke saath. Ab wo kaun se factors hain unki taraf aate hain jo ki distress cause karte hain in HCWs on a larger scale. आपके पास एक तो कंपैशन फटीग हो गया और मॉरल डिस्ट्रेस जिसकी हम बात कर चुके हैं, बट देर आर टू मोर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट फैक्टर्स जो कि हैं सिस्टम इंड्यूस्ड डिस्ट्रेस एंड पर्सनल फैक्टर्स. सिस्टम इंड्यूस्ड डिस्ट्रेस के आपकी ऑर्गेनाइजेशन आपका किस तरह ख्याल रख रही है या नहीं रख रही है, आपको क्या रिसोर्सेज दे रही है या नहीं दे रही है. एंड देन पर्सनल फैक्टर्स, एग्जाम्पल परफेक्शनिज्म, हमारा वैल्यू सिस्टम, हमारी लाइफ फिलोसफी हमें किस तरह पुश कर रही है टूवर्ड्स से बर्निंग आउट our resources, our inner resources. And of course, burnout, agar ye chronically chalte rahenge, hum inko address nahi karenge, so then it will lead to burnout, which may lead to depression and anxiety. And again, how does this go from thriving to burnout? If you see ki we ideally in a utopian world, we want to live in the thriving and surviving zone. Thriving is when your mood and your physical health and your relational aspect of your lives are in a robust state. हम जब robust का word इस्तेमाल करते हैं उसके मानी ये है कि आपकी relationships अच्छी हैं, balanced हैं, there's a sense of happiness, ऊंच नीच हर चीज में आती है, आपकी work life में आएगी, आपकी personal life में आएगी. लेकिन you're managing that in a way कि there's more goodness. Ideally, there should be more goodness rather than bad in the personal or professional life, and that balances it out. Maximum surviving thick giant, the yellow column, nervousness, sadness, inconsistent performance now and then. But orange and red are danger zones. You don't want to enter that. Please remember this, this image that in an ideal world or even in a non-ideal world, that's why I've included surviving as well, ke yellow se zyada aap na padhe. And yellow bhi kuch arse ke liye, not consistently. We don't want to get into, I can't keep this up, I can't survive this, subah uthne mein masla, aap मतलब जिसे कहते हैं ना एक डर पैदा हो जाए कि मुझे काम पे जाना है, दैट शुडंट हैपन. आपकी केयरलेस मिस्टेक्स हो जाती है, एंड एंड ऑफ द डे व्हाट हैपेंस इज इट अफेक्ट्स क्वालिटी ऑफ केयर टुवर्ड्स योर पेशेंट्स एंड ऑफ कोर्स रिड्यूसेस द ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस परफॉर्मेंस एंड क्रिएट्स अ बैड इंपैक्ट ऑन द ऑर्गेनाइजेशन एज वेल एंड कैन लीड टू लाइफ एंड डेथ सिचुएशंस. जहां हम क्लिनिशियन वेलबींग और रेजिलियंस की बात करते हैं तो चार फैक्टर्स अगेन आर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट टू मेक श्योर दैट अ क्लिनिशियन और हेल्थ केयर वर्कर इज लुक्ड आफ्टर. अब इधर जो है सेल्फ अवेयरनेस इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट, एंड जिसमें आपका माइंडफुलनेस आ जाता है, न्यूट्रिशन, एक्सरसाइज एंड स्लीप, रिलेशनशिप्स आपकी जो है वो आर वेल लुक्ड आफ्टर. Spiritually, you're well looked after, you find meaning and fulfillment, and you have a life philosophy that is ideally work-life balance. Jahan tak self-awareness ka taluq hai, main ye kehti chalungi ki self-awareness jo hai, jise hum khud agahi kehte hain, ki agar mujhe nahi pata chalega mere saath kya ho raha hai, if I'm not aware ke mere jism mein, mere jazbaat mein aur mere rooh mein kya मसले चल रहे हैं या क्या रुकावटें आ रही हैं या क्या तकलीफें हैं, तो मैं ना उसका हल ढूंढ सकूंगी या ना मैं उसको मैं अपने साथ जिसे कहते हैं एक जस्टिस कर सकूंगी अपनी जात के साथ. न्यूट्रिशन, एक्सरसाइज एंड स्लीप हर किसी के अलग रिक्वायरमेंट होती है. रिलेशनल वेलबींग, यू नो योर रिलेशनशिप विथ योर पेरेंट्स, योर चिल्ड्रन, योर स्पाउसेस, योर रोमांटिक पार्टनर्स एंड spiritual, चाहे आप हिंदू हो, क्रिश्चियन हो, एथियस्ट हो, कोई भी हो, इफ यू हैव अ कनेक्शन, यू मे हैव अ कनेक्शन विद द यूनिवर्स, द पर्टिकुलर एंटिटी, डेटी, व्हाटएवर, फाइंडिंग मीनिंग इन दैट. एंड यूजुअली जब हम बर्नआउट की तरफ जाते हैं तो ये इम्पैक्ट होना शुरू हो जाते हैं. ना ऑर्गेनाइजेशनल लेवल पे फेयर पे एंड हेल्थ केयर इनक्रेडिबली इंपॉर्टेंट. अगर आपने यू वॉन्ट टू क्रिएट एन एनवायरमेंट इन विच अ पर्सन फील्स लुक्ड आफ्टर, रोटी कपड़ा मकान अमूमन एक कहा जाता था, पुराना एक स्लोगन था. तो जब तक हमारे पास ये बेसिक्स नहीं होंगे तो हमारे लिए एडिशनल स्ट्रेसर्स होंगे, हमारी बहुत जिंदगी मुश्किल हो जाती है, तो हमारी वर्क परफॉर्मेंस भी इम्पैक्ट होती है. उसके अलावा वर्क कल्चर, कि हम किस किस्म का वर्क कल्चर प्रोपेगेट कर रहे हैं. ओवरवर्क का जो कल्चर है वो बहुत रैम्पेंट है. खून पसीना एक कर, उन्हें खून पसीना एक नहीं करना प्लीज, यू डोंट वांट टू डू दैट, यू वांट टू हैव अ बैलेंस. जैसे हम कहते हैं ना, किसी भी चीज की एक्सट्रीम इज नॉट गुड, वर्कहोलिज्म इज एन इश्यू. इट्स इंपॉर्टेंट टू ऑल्सो हैव मेंटोरशिप. और मेंटोरशिप में हमारे जैसे मेंटल हेल्थ काउंसलिंग में वी हैव अ वेरी स्ट्रिक्ट रूल ऑफ सुपरविजन एंड वी गो टू आवर सुपरवाइजर्स व्हेन वी आर इन डिस्ट्रेस अबाउट आवर वर्क अबाउट आवर लाइव्स एंड दे प्रोवाइड अ वेरी सपोर्टिव आई हैव एक्चुअली एक्सपीरियंस अ वेरी सपोर्टिव एनवायरमेंट थ्रू माई सुपरवाइजर्स मेंटल हेल्थ केयर सपोर्ट ग्रुप्स बैलेंस्ड ग्रुप्स इन विच मेंटल हेल्थ काउंसलर और थेरेपिस्ट और साइकोलॉजिस्ट इज ओवरसीइंग द ग्रुप ऑफ हेल्थ केयर वर्कर्स who are looking after others. So, inki emotional well-being, inki struggles, ko jise kehte hain, ek arena mil jati, platform mil jata hai to be addressed. And then resources. Is the organization providing resources, such as recharging stations, child care facilities? Itte saari humari population bada rahi hai, to bache hain na humare. To wo kahan jayen? हर किसी की फैमिली नहीं होती, हर किसी के पास हेल्प की फैसिलिटी नहीं होती है कि भाई मैं आयाज इतनी ले सकूं और फिर उनको मॉनिटर कौन करेगा. सो हैविंग सेफ चाइल्ड केयर फैसिलिटीज इन द ऑर्गेनाइजेशन इज इनक्रेडिबली इम्पॉर्टेंट. ऑन अ कम्युनिटी लेवल हैविंग डोनेशंस, वॉलंटियरिज्म, डिस्काउंट्स एंड स्पेशल्स एंड डोनेशंस ऑफ वॉलंटियरिज्म तो है हमारे पास, बट I think shops and consumer goods ke jo hamare areas hain, such as you know grocery stores, clothing stores, tech ke jo stores hain, to offer even agar thoda sa discount de de healthcare workers, so that serves as an incentive as well, because ye log they go above and beyond the call of duty a lot of times. Enforce COVID safe measures, right? चूंकि कोविड है तो अगर हम मेजर्स एनफोर्स करेंगे तो हमारी जो हॉस्पिटल्स इस वक्त इनंडेटेड हैं, जो हैव फेस्ड सो मच इन्फ्लक्स ऑफ पेशेंट्स, वो कम होगा तो उनका जो हेल्थ केयर वर्कर्स का है उनका प्रेशर भी कम होगा. पॉलिस ऑन द स्टेट लेवल, राइट, दिस इंक्लूड्स स्टेट एज वेल नाउ, दिस होल डायग्राम के पॉलिसीज कि हम किस तरह की पॉलिसीज इनैक्ट कर रहे हैं, रीइंफोर्स कर रहे हैं, जहां हॉस्पिटल्स और हेल्थ केयर फैसिलिटीज हैव सर्टेन रूल्स एंड रेगुलेशंस एंड स्टैंडर्ड्स ऑफ केयर फॉर देयर स्टाफ एज वेल एज फॉर द पेशेंट्स. रिसर्च लेजिस्लेशन के क्या रूल्स एंड रेगुलेशंस हैं फॉर रिसर्च, क्या फैसिलिटीज प्रोवाइड की जा रही है, क्या फंडिंग प्रोवाइड की जा रही है, एंड लीगल रिकोर्स. अगर एक एक स्टाफ को जो है वो नहीं मिल रहा है आपको जस्ट डिसीजन रिगार्डिंग एनी, इट कुड बी हरासमेंट, इट कुड बी बुलिंग, एनी थिंग, या नॉट गेटिंग फेयर पे, तो वो कहाँ से रिकोर्स लेगा अगर ह्यूमन सर्विसेज उसको नहीं प्रोवाइड करी. सो हैविंग अ वेरी वेल इन्फॉर्म्ड ह्यूमन सर्विस ह्यूमन रिसोर्स डिपार्टमेंट हु आर आई थिंक साइकोलॉजिकली ट्रेन्ड एज वेल एंड बींग एबल टू आइडेंटिफाई सर्टन इशूज एंड बींग एबल टू प्रोवाइड एन एम्पथेटिक एनवायरमेंट टू देयर टू द पीपल हु कम टू देम इज ऑल्सो इम्पॉर्टेंट. अब हम आते हैं एक बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट फैक्टर जो कि इंडिविजुअल लेवल पे था, सेल्फ कंपैशन. सेल्फ कंपैशन रिसर्च शोज दैट इट मेक्स अस हैप्पियर, इट मेक्स अस लेस स्ट्रेस्ड एंड मोर रेजिलिएंट. हम अपने आप का जब ख्याल रख सकते हैं तो हम दूसरे का भी ख्याल रख पाते हैं. जब हम सेल्फ कंपैशन प्रैक्टिस करते हैं तो हमारी रिलेशनशिप अपने आप से बेहतर होती है, हमारी रिलेशनशिप दूसरों से बेहतर होती है, एंड दैट इंक्लूड्स लुकिंग आफ्टर आवर नीड्स, हमारी तकलीफ, हमारी बींग अवेयर ऑफ क्या चीज हमें तकलीफ देती है, क्या चीज हमें अच्छी लगती है, क्या चीज हमें नहीं अच्छी लगती है. इट ऑल्सो रिड्यूसेस आवर परफेक्शनिस्टिक टेंडेंसीज व्हेन वी आर काइंडर टू आवरसेल्फ्स. इट्स ओके इफ आई मेड अ मिस्टेक, होती हैं मिस्टेक्स, हाउ कैन आई फिक्स इट, हुम डू आई रीच आउट टू. हमारे कल्चर में यह बहुत एक मिस्टेक मत मानना अपनी, क्योंकि अगर मिस्टेक मान ली तो बस कयामत आ जाएगी, राइट. इट मेक्स अस मोर रेजिलिएंट. जब हम एक गाड़ी में फ्यूल नहीं भरेंगे, हम बोलेंगे वो गाड़ी जो है लंबी लंबी राउट्स पे जाए तो वो तो नहीं जा पाएगी ना, तो रुक जाएगी. इसी तरह अंडरस्टैंड कि सेल्फ कंपैशन इज फ्यूल फॉर योर सोल. वो क्या एक्सरसाइजेस हैं की कंपैशन की जो कि हमें हेल्प करेंगी? ब्रीद एंड बी माइंडफुल. हम भूल जाते हैं कि ब्रेथ इज वन थिंग दैट वी आर बोर्न विद एंड द लास्ट थिंग दैट लीव्स आवर बॉडीज. एंड इफ यू डोंट नो हाउ टू कंट्रोल आवर ब्रेथ एंड हाउ टू एनहेंस आवर ब्रीदिंग एंड अंडरस्टैंडिंग कि अगर हम ब्रीथ सही से नहीं कर रहे तो हम अपना कोर्टिसोल लेवल भी बढ़ा रहे हैं, हम अपना स्ट्रेस लेवल भी बढ़ा रहे हैं, राइट, एंड दैट्स नॉट हेल्पिंग अस. अक्सर मैंने ऐसे किया है कि व्हेन आई वुड बी वर्किंग इन इंडस एंड मेरे पास टाइम नहीं होता था कि मैं बैठ के मेडिटेट कर सकूँ, सो व्हाइल आई वुड बी वॉकिंग फ्रॉम वन वार्ड टू द नेक्स्ट और फ्रॉम माई ऑफिस टू द वार्ड, आई जस्ट बी ब्रीदिंग, I'd just be focusing on my breath, right? And just inhale and a longer exhale. Just remember, a much longer exhale. Connect with your breath. Develop a relationship with your breath. It really will help you and give back to you. एंड बी माइंडफुल बीइंग इन द मोमेंट. जहन इधर उधर जो जा रहा होता है उससे हमारे फोकस हटता है, हमारे कॉन्सेंट्रेशन खत्म होती है, एंड वी लूज समटाइम्स द गुड थिंग्स दैट आर हैपनिंग इन द प्रेजेंट. क्योंकि या तो हम आगे के बारे में परेशान हो रहे होते हैं या हम पीछे के बारे में परेशान होते हैं. And imagine yourself as your friend whom you're advising, especially in times when you're pushing yourself beyond your capacity. कि अगर मेरा कोई दोस्त आता है, मेरी कोई दोस्त आती है मुझसे पूछती, तो मैं उसको क्या बोलती, क्या advice देती, right? So अपने आप को imagine करें कि आप दोस्त हैं जो आ रहे हैं, आपका दोस्त आके आपसे पूछ रहा है कि मैं इस कस्मा पुरसी की हालत में हूँ, इस परेशानी में हूँ, मैं क्या करूँ. What advice would you give them? Would you be as hard on them as you are to yourself? Social support. Your friends and family are incredibly important support systems. Massage, soothing touch like a hug or holding hands. Also very important. Very important. They release the feel-good hormones in the body that you require to create that balance and to create that, you know, compassionate space for you. And stop the self-criticism. Maine ye kyun nahi kiya? Maine aisa kyun kar diya? Take a step back and say, okay, maine ye sahi nahi kiya. How can I fix it? मैंने ये मिस्टेक कर दी, आई एम सॉरी अबाउट दिस, लेट्स फाइंड आउट द बेस्ट वे टू डील विद इट एंड रिजॉल्व इट, राइट? बीइंग एबल टू अपोलोजाइज एज वेल टू वन सेल्फ एंड टू अनदर, आई एम सॉरी आई वाज सो मीन टू माय सेल्फ, बीइंग एबल टू से दैट टू वन, दैट सेल्फ डायलॉग इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट, एंड बीइंग एबल टू से इट टू अनदर, लर्निंग टू से नो एंड डिसअपॉइंट, इंटेग्रल. कभी कभी दूसरों को डिसअपॉइंट करना पड़ता है एंड इट इज ओके, इट इज ओके. Right? And that doesn't mean कि आपको कोई काम दिया गया है जिसके आपने हाँ की हो और आप फिर बोले कि नहीं मैं नहीं कर सकती, कि जी इरम ने तो कहा था कि disappoint करें. But खास तौर पे this is for people who are perfectionists, who cannot say no, who don't believe in disappointing. Right? Boundaries, boundaries and boundaries. Cannot stress enough. Understanding कि क्या आपका, this creates work-life balance. कि क्या चीज मैं कर सकती हूँ, क्या चीज मैं नहीं कर सकती, क्या मेरे value system के खिलाफ है, क्या मुझे हार्म करेगी. अक्सर हम कहते हैं कि बस सैक्रिफाइस करते रहो. दैट्स नॉट द आइडियल सिनेरियो, राइट? कितना सैक्रिफाइस करेंगे? एक सैक्रिफाइस कर दी, फिर थोड़ा सा ठहर जाएं, सांस लें, राइट? अपने बारे में थोड़ा सोचिए, अपने अपनी जात पे जुल्म ना करें प्लीज. एक दफा इस्लामियत क्लास में आई स्टिल रिमेम्बर दैट, कि हमसे कहा गया था कि कहाँ पढ़ा था कि तुम्हारी जात से, तुम्हारे जिस्म से पूछा जाएगा तुमने उसका किस तरह ख्याल रखा है, और आपकी रूह, आपका जहन, आपका दिल उस जात का हिस्सा है, उस जिस्म का हिस्सा है. तो जब हम माइंडफुल स्टेट की बात करते हैं, मैं पहले भी बात कर चुकी हूँ इसकी, दिस इज जस्ट अ क्विक ग्राफिक एंड वॉट इज अ माइंडफुल स्टेट, जो हमें रोकता है डिप्रेशन की तरफ जाने से, एंजाइटी की तरफ जाने से, एंड देयर इज ट्रेमेंडस अमाउंट्स ऑफ रिसर्च ऑन दिस. माइंडलेस ये है कि आपको एक स्टिम्यूलस आया, एक सिचुएशन खड़ी हुई और आपने रिएक्ट किया बगैर सोचे समझे, बगैर रुके हुए. माइंडफुल स्टेट वो है कि एक स्टिम्यूलस आया, एक चीज सिचुएशन खड़ी हुई, आपने कहा रुक जाओ, लेट मी थिंक अबाउट इट एंड देन रिस्पॉन्ड. रिएक्शन जो है वो माइंडलेसनेस से आता है. अ माइंडफुल स्टेट क्रिएट्स अ रिस्पॉन्स, नॉट अ रिएक्शन. अगर कोई चीज आपको तंग करिए, ठहर जाइए, सोचिए और फिर आगे बढ़िए. And mindfulness or being mindful of yourself, being mindful of your likes and dislikes, your happinesses and sadnesses is self-compassion. Aur yaad rakhiye, compassion for others begins with the self. Thank you so much for listening to me today. Take good care of yourselves.
Now I'd like to present Dion Sears and Tara Farley to speak about mental health in a healthcare setting, No One Left Behind for Parents.
Thank you, Dion, and thank you to the ICON conference for having us today. So I am going to talk you through a case that I have recently worked with to explain how we do our assessments, our formulations and our treatment plans, and how we assist a family and parents specifically through the hospitalization and of their sick child. So this is a young baby, a 3-month-old baby, who I worked with. We will call baby X. And baby X is the youngest of two siblings. Mom and dad are originally from India, and they are expats here living in Qatar. So the initial assessment that I completed with the family is kind of the foundation for where you will formulate your treatment plan. This is a gathering exercise, gathering information about their history, as Dion has kind of referenced, their psychosocial environment, employment, support systems, and indeed their personality traits, strengths, and any other relevant family background information, which you can see here in this biopsychosocial model of assessment. So from this family, things that I considered were the stress of the hospitalization, the worry for the infant's future, separation from family members back in India and limited support network, childcare issues, caring for the eldest child while father worked full time and while mom was torn between being with the baby in the inpatient unit in hospital and being with her four-year-old son at home. The reason for the initial referral to social work in this instance came as for financial reasons, but as it turned out, a lot of the work that we ended up doing with the family was on coping, resiliency, parenting capacity, and building on parents' self-esteem and confidence. So often what happens with our assessments is we might get a referral for one reason, but through the social work assessment, you might find out there's an awful lot more going on. The initial stages of work with a family is always focused on establishing a therapeutic relationship where the family can trust you and can share their worries and their concerns. Once you have this solid foundation of a relationship as a social worker or as a, indeed, any other healthcare professional, you're able to use your skills to put in place to enhance, I guess, their coping and their resiliency. And we do this by exploring their strengths, their resources within the community. Indeed, with this family, for example, mom had a very good friend who wasn't in the country, but who was living rather in Australia. And I encouraged her to utilize that relationship as somebody who she could talk to and share her worries and concerns with. Similarly, in this instance, mom and dad had a very close relationship. And part of the social work role was to encourage them to lean on one another for support. Mom had some childhood trauma. So in our third session, we were able to look at that and evaluate the impact of that trauma on her current coping mechanisms and how that might be impacting her parenting values and indeed how she manages her stress while in the hospital. Sessions 4, 5, and 6, which is the bulk of your sessions, focused on promoting the relationship between the mother and the child, because often what we will see with parents who have children in the ICU or the hospital environment is they feel disengaged maybe from their child because of all the wires and the nursing care that's being provided, and they may feel displaced from their parenting role. So a social worker will try to emphasize, you know, as the parent, you are still there to do the bathing, to do the storytelling, to do the hand-holding, and the irreplaceable bond between parent and child. Parents who have children in the ICU will often have valid worries about the future, what might happen. And so as a social worker, you might employ CBT to work through whether those thoughts and beliefs are helpful or unhelpful, and what other ways there are to distinguish more helpful thoughts and behaviors around the subject of the child's illness. So one thing that I will often do is use mindfulness techniques and breathing techniques with the families so they can become more centered and cope better. (Clears throat) The final sessions in working with these families will be to evaluate how effective some of the self-care and mindfulness practices that you've taught have been. In this instance with this family, mom still needed further support. So what I did was I referred to our psychiatry team, who were able to assess mom, and then we were able to work alongside from a counseling and therapeutic way, alongside the use of medication to treat the anxiety for mom. We've talked a little bit about the importance of self-care here today, and I'm just conscious that we're limited on time. So I want to share some of the things that we would look at. When we talk about self-care, we're talking about resources in the family, friends, ministers in the community, things that the parents are doing physically to look after themselves. So are they getting the right nutrition, exercise, sleep? Are they able to spend time for themselves to read or to ask for help, for example? We also touched on the importance of working with parents to help them to relax and de-stress and breathe. So one thing that I will work with parents on is taking time out, being mindful of their thoughts, and utilizing kind of mindful breathing at times of crisis and distress, and providing psychoeducation on breathing techniques. So for example, when you're quite stressed, you will breathe shallow. A good technique to use is to try to breathe deeply into the lungs, and this will help to oxygenate the body. Another slide we have here is on self-care, and we will go through this with each family member to reinforce with them how to self-care and what helps at times of distress. Lastly, I want to just draw your attention to why we have mental health providers in pediatric settings working with families and children. So as mental health providers, we're acutely aware of the issues that are presented to families. We will help the families to navigate the hospital environment. We will advocate for patient and family care, assist parents to regulate their emotions and enhance their coping skills, and provide psychoeducation and information on a range of topics that are relevant to them, strengthen collaborative care between the families and the medical teams, promote the parents' role and encourage them to perform cares such as bathing, story time, etc., provide supportive counselling, and also process trauma and grief relating to hospitalisation and possible previous losses. Thank you for inviting us for this conference. We've been very happy to be part of it, and that is the end of our presentation, and we have references for your information as well. Thank you.
Now Dion Sears will speak about the importance of mental health in a pediatric setting as well.
Hello, I'm Dion Sears, and I will be presenting with my colleague Tara Farley. And we're going to look at the experiences of parents and caregivers in healthcare settings. At the end of our presentation, you will have a better understanding of the experiences that caregivers and parents of children who are hospitalized experience. We also want to leave you with more awareness of how a mental health collaborative care model can be done within a hospital setting. And lastly, you will learn some tips of how psychosocial professionals can provide mental health support to parents of pediatric patients while hospitalized. A child's illness or hospitalization is a major family crisis. It can have lasting impacts on the child and their families. In North America, children with medical complexities account for 49% of pediatric hospital stays. Of course, this number has significantly increased given the COVID pandemic that we're experiencing. And the caregivers of these children often provide a source of quality of life, well-being, and quality care during their hospitalization. These caregivers, unfortunately, also experience unique challenges, whether it's due to poor care coordination because they're working with multiple providers, or it's because of the stressors of a prolonged hospitalization. Often they experience physical and psychological burdens. These consequences can negatively affect them emotionally and increase their stress. It can also seriously impact their ability to take care of their child. The important thing here is to understand that the prevalence of psychosocial risk in caregivers of children with medical complexities are among the highest in pediatric population. So in addition to the physical and emotional consequences that these caregivers experience, they may also face limited financial resources because of the length of time they're in the hospital, the child's in the hospital. Their social support may decrease. They may experience burnout and increased stress. Sometimes the families are separated, especially if they are younger children at home. Oftentimes these caregivers are concerned about the ill child's future and what a prolonged hospitalization may do. Overall, many of these caregivers experience decreased quality of life, and the family functioning can be disrupted. Here in Qatar, in 2013, the state of Qatar implemented the Qatar National Mental Health Strategy. It was launched to help establish integrated mental health and well-being services for the people in Qatar. At the time, 1 in 5 people were affected by mental illness, and mental health was among the top 3 causes of disabilities in Qatar. What we knew at the time from the research was that 4 out of 5 people with mental illness disorders faced stigma. And globally, research has been done to look at strategies of how to decrease stigma, specifically in Arab families and population. Research has focused on how to provide comprehensive treatment interventions that are aimed at understanding Arab families' beliefs, attitudes, experiences, in conjunction with the family and the social context. Evidence from North America also shows that patients tend to choose non-physician behavioral health providers, such as clinical social workers, to receive mental health treatment because it also causes them to experience less stigma. At SIDRA, we continue to fulfill our duties to meet the mental health needs of patients and caregivers through our vision. So SIDRA is a 400-bed pediatric and women hospital that was opened in 2016, the outpatient unit, and 2018, our inpatient bed was established. And we also provide mental health care and treatment here in our facility. At SIDRA, the social workers not only provide traditional medical social work services such as discharge planning and identifying resources within the community, but the clinical social workers here are also equipped to provide comprehensive assessment and treatment of mental illness, emotional and other behavioral disturbances. As a profession, we recognize the correlation between the physical, psychological, and spiritual well-being of patients and how that impacts their physical health. We use measurement-based care. So this is where you are merging, we are merging research, the findings of research with our clinical practice to help improve and inform our treatment planning. We provide advocacy for our families and our caregivers. We also provide psychosocial, psychoeducation to our families as well. Our psychosocial assessment really is a tool we use to examine the whole person. We focus not just on the physical, mental, and social, but we also examine the systems that the patients and the families interact with so that we can have a comprehensive picture of what is going on with these families. One of the models that we use here at SIDGR, we've adapted a mental health collaborative care model to help meet the needs of our patients and our caregivers. So a collaborative care model provides an opportunity to integrate mental health and medical care for our patients. As an organization, like I mentioned, the organization supports this because it's in line with our national mental health strategies that the country has established. So what we do is every other month, we do an intake, multidisciplinary intake with a psychiatrist, psychologist, social workers, in which we look at our patients that are coming into with mental health needs. These patients are then triaged and depending on their acuity or their needs are referred to psychiatrists, clinical psychologists, or clinical social workers. These providers will all do comprehensive assessment and this will inform their treatment planning. The information is within our clinical systems. So it's shared among the providers. It's protected as well. So not all providers will have the opportunity to see information, especially if it's sensitive. The patients get to engage in their treatment, not just with their through psychoeducation, but they also are able to meet and speak with the providers as they need. Finally, we provide linkage to the community if the treatment or the patient has aged out or the resources may not necessarily be within our institution, we may refer them to community. I am going to hand over to my colleague, Tara, who will share a case example and talk about how all of these pieces interplay to support the patients as well as the caregivers of our pediatric patients.
So now I would like to present Katie Taylor, who will speak about mental health in a healthcare setting, No One Left Behind for patients. I hope you guys enjoy.
Hi, my name is Katie Taylor. I am a certified child life specialist, and I just want to thank you so much for inviting me to come speak about the very important work of supporting children and their families in the healthcare setting. It has been a crazy 2 years with the pandemic. And so the fact that this community here at ICON 2022 finds the value in psychosocial care and wants to make this a presentation speaks volumes about the kind of care that you all are giving. So I'm honored to be here. I am on the other side of the world. I am in Austin, Texas. And to give you just a little insight about what is happening in Austin right now, I believe 3 days ago, it was about 75 and we woke up the other morning and it was 23 degrees. So it is just crazy right here as far as the temperature change goes. And so that is the environment that I'm in. So to tell you a little bit about myself, just so we can get to know each other, and then I'll go into the role of a child life specialist and try to let you leave here today with some tangible ideas and suggestions about how to connect on a psychosocial level with your patients and families. So as I said, my name is Katie. I am a certified child life specialist for the past 12 years. I did my undergrad at Penn State University in Pennsylvania. And then from there, I pursued child life, and I did some training at Children's National Medical Center in Washington, D.C. I then went to Inova Children's Hospital in Northern Virginia. I've also worked here in Austin, Texas at two different children's facilities, Dell Children's Medical Center, as well as St. David's. I've worked in both acute and chronic, intensive and regular medical surgical units, as well as a NICU. And so I think this kind of vast experience within the healthcare setting has really equipped me for the role that I'm in now, which is CEO and founder of Child Life on Call. So Child Life on Call was born as a podcast about 4.5 years ago. I myself was becoming a mother and really looked to community to kind of get prepared for the experience of becoming a mom. And what I really saw that lacked was community for parents who have a child with medical or special needs. And that's not to say that there aren't amazing organizations out there. I was just thinking about how can we give families an easy way to connect with one another. And that's when podcasts were beginning to just kind of take shape. And I really saw an opportunity to provide parents with connection without having to do a whole lot of work. If you are a parent, especially a parent of a child with medical needs, then you know you're exhausted at the end of the day. That's all parents really, but the least amount of work you have to do to kind of fill your cup, the easier it is. And I think podcasts are a great way of connecting with someone. If you don't like what they're saying, you can just move on to the next episode. So I'm proud to say we have over 100 stories on the podcast right now. So whether you're a parent or a medical professional and you want to hear about the parent perspective, it's a great way to learn from each other. So from the podcast, we have developed a mobile application, which is actually designed to expand child life services in the hospital environment. So Tuba, who is the wonderful woman who invited me to come and speak at this conference, is a part of your psychosocial department. And she offers child life services. And what the app does is it extends child life services pre-admission and post-discharge. So while nothing replaces that face-to-face that Tuba and the child life specialist in your organizations can give you, there is a component of child life that can be helpful both pre and post-admission. So that's what we're launching here in the US here in 2022, and it's very exciting. So you may be wondering, what is this lady? She keeps saying child life specialist. What does that mean? And we here, I can describe for you what it looks like in the United States. We are an integral part of the healthcare team. So that means that we attend rounds, we have access to charting. We are one of the multidisciplinary teams. We can see any patient from 0 to 18 and even preterm. So that's kind of where our role is. We provide, we have a background in psychosocial and child development. So what we have are the skills and the tools to be able to relate them to medical experiences. The other training we have is we know what the impact of healthcare and medical experiences and trauma and all of these things have on children and the family unit. So we marry those two things together. So you may see a child life specialist here in the US, blowing bubbles with a child who is in respiratory distress, who has to do an incentive spirometer act. So rather than just having the child try to blow into something to practice moving air, we may suggest doing something like bubbles, which is more play-based, and the child may be more interested in participating. We can provide appropriate diagnosis education. It is hard to explain to a four-year-old that they have cancer. But with child life specialists, know if we connect with them at their developmental level, we can actually explain it in a way that they can understand. And that helps take some of the stress off parents, like how will I know how to talk to my child? We are there for procedural support, which includes preparation prior to an event or medical experience happening. We are there during the actual procedure. So whether I'm in the trauma bay at the head of the bed, if the child is awake and describing to them what is happening, or I am with a child as they are receiving a PICC line, a peripherally inserted central catheter, and they need to stay awake for it, I can be there to help support them. We help with the whole family unit. We know that when a child is hospitalized, it doesn't just affect the child. It actually affects the siblings too. It affects the aunties and the uncles and all of these people who are involved. And so we have a holistic approach to this family system about how we're going to support the patient. We are there for end of life too, which is such a great honor to be able to provide items for the family to take home, whether it's handprints or footprints or a lock of hair, or just something that we can do so that the family can leave feeling like their child was loved for and cared for, and they can leave with something. We can actually help with grief sessions and help children and families cope and be prepared for the death of their parent or their grandparent in many different areas. So another thing that we really help with is routine within the hospital. So we know that children cope best when they have boundaries and they know what to expect and what's coming next. So we may do medication charts or daily routines for those children who are in the hospitals for a longer length of stay, and really find that just coming back on that core concept of routine and boundary can help a child thrive in the hospital. So I'm speaking to a group of medical professionals who are experts in their field, right? And so you have done so much training. You are very, very good at what you do. But it reminds me of the phrase that every NICU, and that's what we call our neonatal intensive care unit, every NICU is a neuro NICU. So what does that mean? So do we need it means that every brain is developing, right? So we need to treat every single preterm infant as if they are in a neuro unit, right? So we keep things quiet and we just adjust the environment to and the skills to support this preterm infant. Well, every single patient is a mental health patient, right? So even if that's not their core concept of why they're there, we need to pretend, we need to understand that every patient is a mental health patient, and we need to be concerned about their mental health as much as their physical health. So you want to know, right, how can I do this quickly while be able to still do my job, my essential duties? How can I provide this kind of support to patients and families? You want a plan to be able to give families to help them cope, right? You want patients to know that they are safe when they're in your care. When they walk into your facility, they are safe, because the truth is we cannot cope with anything if we don't feel safe. That is the underground, that is the foundation of children and families coping in the hospital, is do they feel safe? You want to help families feel empowered, right? Because when families are empowered and they understand what's happening, they understand the plan, they're more likely to succeed, and not only succeed and thrive, but things get done a lot faster when you have a family that is understanding and on board. So what is the cost of not doing this, of not considering psychosocial support? It can lead to increased cost of medical care due to unnecessary anesthetics. The reason I bring that up is because it is expensive to provide anesthesia services. And if you have a well-equipped 8-year-old with maybe some preparation and support who could get through an MRI without being sedated, it saves both the facility and the family a lot of money and time and resources. And so why not consider providing psychosocial preparation prior to assess your patients and say, do they need this anesthesia? Without psychosocial support, there is increased anxiety. There are worsening outcomes, right? Because of this kind of negative association with the medical experience. There is low adherence to medical procedures. So that means your patient is less likely to want to take their medicine and follow up and do all of the things that you are recommending for their health to get better. There are time delays. So here in the United States, prior to going back to surgery, let's say a child life specialist will meet the patient and the family ahead of time prior to surgery, so that when that separation, if it does need to happen between the child and parent, both are well equipped with the plan about what's going to happen and how we're going to get through it. Otherwise, you're prying a child from a parent's arms, and that can lead to a negative experience, not just for the child, but for the parent and for the staff too, right? That's not something that you like to see. There can be a misunderstanding, and which can cause a lack of communication between the patient and family and the healthcare team. An example I often give is in the podcast, I was interviewing a mother who had a baby who was born with HIE. And so when they were born, there were a lot of issues, especially with breathing. And the mom was so tired. She had just been pregnant for 9 months. She had two other children at home. She was not prepared for a NICU stay. And she just kept hearing the word pneumonia, pneumonia. And so finally on day 10, the doctor sits her down and says, "We just want to let you know that your son developed pneumonia." And she said, "Well, isn't that why we're here?" And the doctor said, "No, where did you get that?" She said, "They've been saying pneumonia to me the whole time." Well, actually they were saying pneumothorax, but she was so tired and no one took the time to explain that a pneumothorax is different than pneumonia. And so she says she just felt totally unequipped to even know what was wrong with her child. And so that's why this kind of inability to provide this psychosocial care can have a long-term impact for the patient and the family, losing trust with the healthcare team. So kids and families, they deserve to have a care team that takes care of their mental health, right? Every child and every patient you see is a mental health patient. They deserve to understand what's happening with their body, right? So just like you, when you go to a bank or you make a financial decision, you deserve to have the information. When you buy a home, when you send your child to school, all of these things, you deserve to have all of the information so you can make the best decision. Children and families deserve that as well. They deserve to know things that happen before they happen, right? They deserve to not be all of a sudden surprised with something that's what's going to happen. And they deserve to be confident advocates in their health. And so I have given you a lot of information about why it is important to provide psychosocial care and what the impact is going to be, both negative and positive. And so through the rest of the presentation, I'm going to make sure you're leaving here feeling well equipped to handle patients and families. So general tenets in working with children, they are not miniature adults. So we cannot assume that the seven-year-old brain is functioning like a 25-year-old brain from a developmental and understanding perspective. So seven-year-olds, sure, they're not toddlers, right? They're talking to us, we assume, we expect a lot, but they are not miniature adults and we cannot treat them that way. The natural language of children is play. And so that's why child life is actually rooted in play, because we know that is the best way to communicate with another child. It's the best way to build rapport. It is the best way to gain trust, and it is the best way to educate. And play doesn't have to be something that is expansive or juvenile. Play is just an opportunity for expression. So play looks at a lot of different things, not just what maybe you think of as a play, but we can use it to our advantage in the hospital and medical setting. Also, no two children are alike. So you might think that if this worked for this patient, it should automatically work for this because they're both three-year-old girls. It doesn't work that way. We all have past histories and experiences that impact how we're going to cope. A thing I want to tell you that is surprising to healthcare workers here in the States is that children have a right to remain silent. When they are put in a situation that makes them feel uncomfortable or they are in pain or you are a stranger to them, the one thing they're able to control is their voice. So when a child is not talking to you, it can be easy for the adult, their caregiver, their parents in the room to say, "Speak up, say hello, say, you know, answer their question. The doctor wants to talk to you." Well, it's actually not that helpful because then they feel forced to have to talk to you if they don't want to. More so validating that they are choosing to remain silent can be way more powerful and build a connection with this family. So an example would be, excuse me, "I can see that you don't want to answer my questions. I understand. I am a new person that you've never met before. I'm going to talk to mom and make sure she knows what's happening. But if you have any questions, why don't you just tell mom and then mom can tell." So immediately you're taking the pressure off of mom for her child to have to perform. And you're developing a trust with the patient because you're recognizing what they want, okay? So it's a really powerful thing to allow children to remain silent. And I guarantee you, if you do that, then you are gonna develop so much more trust than if you were to force them to speak. So I like to think about what could be stressful for a patient or family in the hospital. It seems pretty easy, but let's hone in on some of the sensory experiences that kids and families are having. So you walk into a room with unfamiliar equipment. There is a thing you're calling a stretcher, which is actually just a bed on wheels, right? That's unfamiliar. It doesn't look like my normal bed at home. If you're in an x-ray room, you're seeing a bunch of things that people are calling cameras, but what you're used to is seeing a camera on a phone. So it looks nothing like that what you're used to. You have stranger anxiety. You may have separation anxiety if you're separated from your caregiver. You have previous medical experiences going to the doctor and getting shots. So automatically, that's probably a question a lot of you hear is, do I have to get a shot today? You have invasive procedures. So no, things aren't always good and great in the hospital. Sometimes they hurt. Sometimes there's pain. And there's high levels of environmental stimulation, which means things are typically colder in a hospital. There are bright lights. The blankets are not usually as soft as the ones at home. So there are a lot of stressors in the hospital to consider before a child even walks in the room. So in order to, now that we know medical stressors, we are going to apply the impact of that stress on children based on their development. And I want to start as early as preterm because these are our most at-risk patients. Their experiences are their world. So children in the NICU can have anywhere from, I think it's 5 to 21 painful procedures per day. And so that is a lot of pain to have to go through. So that's why caring touch times and coordinating care so that you're not having to overstimulate the infant are so important. And that's why having mom or dad or caregiver nearby to provide loving touch as a supplement to these painful touches that they're getting is incredibly important. Kangaroo care, in which you're encouraging and facilitating, which is a big part, the parent actually sitting with the child on their chest doing skin to skin has a huge neurodevelopmental impact on the infant and also the parent. And so when I say facilitating, parents aren't necessarily comfortable in the NICU. To a surprise, they may not even want to be there. It stresses them out. They're upset and worried for their child. They're maybe intimidated by the care team. So all of these things will affect the parent's ability to care for their child like they want to. They also don't know how to handle this preterm infant. So that's why facilitating this experience where you're connecting parent and child, especially in the NICU, is so important. Don't underestimate the impact of teaching a parent a containment hold where we're cupping the hands at the feet and we're cupping here at the top of the head and we're providing this containment, right? That feels so safe and secure to the infant. And then the parent realizes they have a job. So something so simple, but incredibly empowering. I'm going to move to the next slide here in which I'm going to share a video. This is an organization that specifically works to provide support to the caregiver in the NICU setting. So we move from this preterm infant to this infant who is now has reached 40 weeks gestation, is born, and their number one stressor is being separated from their parent. So the more time we can put infants with their caregiver, especially the mother, the more likely they are to have a better outcome. So if you have a patient that comes into your hospital that is an infant, the last thing you should do is take the baby from the mother's arms, which causes stress not just for baby, but for mom too. And so try to keep them connected as much as possible. Encourage mother to support her child. Here we will encourage the mother to breastfeed while we give vaccinations. We will put in a pacifier so that the infant is soothed if the mother doesn't want to breastfeed. Whatever we can do to calm the infant and keep them swaddled as much as possible is what we do. And so we want parents to also feel empowered. They feel a loss of control when their child is sick, especially their brand new baby. And so empowering them to say, "Mom, you are doing a good job. I want you to keep the baby swaddled. Can you sing in a soft, calm voice? Can you pat baby on the back?" Or just small little things to make the parent feel included, make a big impact. Next, we move to toddlers, those little toddlers. And, you know, we call them toddlers because they literally have big heads and small bodies and they toddle all over the place. And so that's why you always see toddlers with head injuries, right? Because they're so top heavy. But they have stress too. So although they aren't able to articulate it, we can see stress in toddlers. Their stressors are a loss of control, right? So they're just beginning to move into the stage of development where they are able to manipulate their environment. So you can hand them a cup and they can throw it on the ground, right? Because they're finding that they can control what's happening. Another stressor for them will be separation from parents. You're going to notice I say that a lot because the parent, the caregiver, is your number one tool in helping a child feel safe, and safety is the foundation. They have decreased self-esteem when they're in the hospital, right? So normally they're able to take the cup and throw it on the ground. Well, here they don't even recognize the cup that you give them. And also stranger anxiety is big for this age group. So about 6 to 9 months to about 18 months to 2 years is really where stranger anxiety starts to demonstrate and show itself in the hospital. Of course, the hospital is a stressful experience, and the strangers around them are wearing hats and maybe masks and pajamas or an isolation gown or gloves and all of these things that make us look so different to what they're used to. And so that is a very typical response. I will tell you the good news. The good news is that toddlers are also very interested in play. And so although you look different, although you have a mask and gloves and an isolation gown and something that is different than usual, children, especially toddlers, are so eager to play with you. So something as simple as carrying a little wand. I don't know if you could see this. I'm going to pull it up. Maybe it's better if it's closer here. Yeah. So this is like a little wand that literally has glitter. You do not need to buy this. You can go take a tube that you put blood in, literally take a little tube, and you can put some sparkles, some glitter, some other little things, and keep this in your pocket. And this is an instant rapport building thing for you to use with a child. So I am in the hospital and I wear an isolation gown and a mask, but as soon as I get down on the child's level, I literally bend down onto my knees and start showing them something or start to play or do peekaboo. We are building a connection, we're building trust, we're building rapport. Also allowing children, especially at this age, to feel the medical equipment before you use it. So letting them touch your stethoscope, right? Letting them put it on, letting them put it on a baby doll or maybe a stuffed animal or mom, the pulse ox. So showing them what the pulse ox looks like on mom before having to put it on them. So all of these techniques and introducing them to the materials before you use it on them can help save a lot of time and anguish in the long run. The next age is we are going to go to preschoolers. And this is the age of magical thinking. This is the age where they want to know if Paw Patrol is real and is Elsa from Frozen, is she real? And it's hard for them to understand that there is an imaginary world because they live in an imaginary world. And so we can use that to our advantage in working with this preschool age. We also call them three-nagers, right? Because they are stubborn, they know exactly what they want, and they try to be the boss, right? That's very, very normal for this age group. They may experience a lack of control in the hospital, so they're used to being able to say, I want this, I want to pee in my diaper, I want to use the toilet or whatever it is. And when they're in the hospital for whatever reason, they may not be able to do these things. So they have a lack of control. They may be attached to safety items. So I really want you to look at this age group who has their blankie or their stuffed animal and look at this relationship between the item and the patient and find it to be incredibly important. And so as you move, maybe a child moves from the bed to maybe a CAT scan machine, can we take the blanket with them? So small things. So what are interventions you can do? You can maximize parent involvement. So encourage the parent to be the one to lift them from the bed to the CAT scan instead of you, a stranger, moving them, taking them away. Encourage the parent to be present there with them. Preparation using hands-on tools. So looking at a CAT scan machine, I'll just continue with this example, is allowing them to see the blanket that is on the bed, touch the bed first, maybe put a little toy or an item on the CAT scan bed first, and just using these play-based techniques to get them familiar with what's about to happen. Allow for control whenever possible. Preschoolers don't have a lot of control when they're there, but one thing they can control is, do I want you to have the blankets on or off? Very simple. Do you want socks on or off? Do you want your medical bracelet on your wrist or your ankle? And so all of these things are tiny choices that can have a big impact, especially for preschoolers. A great rapport building and also assessment piece is to play I Spy. So as I described, I come into the room, I get down on their level, and if I'm trying to build rapport with them, I may ask, if I have my badge, my hospital badge on here, I may say, can I show you the sticker that's on my badge? I have a little rainbow right here. What's your favorite color on this rainbow? And so I'm using play, right? I'm using something that they're used to, which is stickers, to gain an assessment and build trust with them. And I can start to wonder, what is your favorite color? Do you know mommy's favorite color? Do you know daddy's favorite color? And so all of a sudden they're in this intimidating environment, but this person is talking to them about something that they understand and can relate to. Preschoolers are really fun. And I have this little picture right here of Star Wars. I was preparing a patient to go back to surgery for an appendectomy. And so actually I believe he was probably 5. So just that older preschool about to move into school age. And so we were talking about what surgery was gonna be like. We talked about sleeping medicine and how he's gonna get that. And then we talked about the appendix and how the appendix is sick inside of his belly. And so the doctor needs to take the appendix out so it doesn't make the rest of his body sick. And so when we did that, I said, so one experience that I have is when I was working with a 5-year-old patient and I was preparing him to go back to surgery to have his appendix removed. That seems like a big thing to tell a 5-year-old, but when I relate the experience and ask him questions, he's more forthcoming and wanting to know and understand what was happening. So we were talking about sleeping medicine and how sleeping medicine is different than sleeping at night, because when you sleep at night, you're sleeping because your body is tired. When you have sleeping medicine, you're sleeping because of medicine. And the sleeping medicine makes it so you can't feel anything, you can't hear anything, so the doctor can take out your appendix. So as the doctor takes out your appendix, I ask, what do you think the doctor is going to use? And he said, probably my safety scissors or my Jedi laser. And I just think that is such a representation of children wanting to relate their world, their imaginative world, and make sense of what is happening there. So I validate that and I say, wow, that would be really cool. Have you used safety scissors before? And I say, and then I actually say what's going to happen. I say the doctor has a special tool that's in charge of taking out the appendix, and that's the thing he's going to use. And then we moved on the conversation. So validating and also helping to identify the misconceptions are important. So when you have a school age, so we're talking about 6 years old and up, their stresses are really about bodily harm. They're scared that things are going to hurt. That's why you may see preschoolers and toddlers perform better with shots than children who are older, right? Because they know the experience, they can understand, and they can also verbalize their fears. They have a threatened sense of self-confidence. So what can you do as the healthcare provider to help make these school-agers feel more comfortable? Ample preparation. So giving them time to ask questions ahead of time, make sure they then know what the experience is, involve the patient in choices, validate their feelings, teach, and then practice coping skills. So actually give them something. So here I'll show you just a small little fidget spinner. If I give them a fidget spinner and I teach them how to hold it, we can say on the count of three, your job is to spin the fidget spinner. 1, 2, 3. And so we're practicing their coping skill to get through something that's painful or uncomfortable. And give privacy whenever possible. that takes us into the adolescence, which privacy is of utmost importance. Their bodies are changing. They are feeling like they are adults, but they are living in a different body. And so they're removed from their social support. So when I walk in and I see a teenager that's looking at their phone and they're scrolling, the last thing I want to do is take their phone away, because that is their sense of support. So eventually we can say that we need to put the phone down. But as the first point of reference with this teenager, I'm not going to be able to develop a lot of rapport if I immediately take away what makes them feel comfortable. Validate their feelings. Be aware of expectations. So we can understand that this may have a small impact on their day, but maybe this injury may not allow them to perform at school or in something they love, or be able to walk to school, or all the different components. So when a patient and family walk into your room, we're able to see things on the outside, right? We can see what clothes they're wearing. We can see their gender, their age. We can see their physical stature. Are there any limitations? Their facial expression. But what can't we see, right? When we're looking at a child, we need to think that they are walking in with some previous experience or some, you know, part of their life that we are unable to see. So maybe they didn't sleep well last night and that's making them upset. Maybe they're hungry and that's making them upset. Maybe there's something stressful that's happening in the home or there's a big change. So these are things we can't see that we need to ask the questions for, so that we're able to adequately provide psychosocial care through this assessment. What can't we see in the parent? They have a lot of stressors that are happening that you can't see that they are bringing with them to this doctor's appointment. We don't understand their level of preparation for what's about to happen. Is it the pneumothorax pneumonia situation where they think they know, but it's actually something completely different? So we need to make sure they're identifying correctly what's going to happen. They may have a child who has been in the NICU, even if that's not the child that they're with. But because of that, when they hear beeps and they hear alarms, their body turns into this fight or flight response because of this traumatic stress from a prior experience. So we don't know these things unless we ask, unless we get the actual assessment. So how do you create successful interventions? Okay, so we talked about why this is important. We talked a little bit about child development and how there are specific stressors for each age group. But how can you walk in and feel more empowered with patients and families? The first thing is to slow down. Talking faster does not make things happen faster. And just getting it done quick typically is not going to work well for a lot of children. So slow down, get down on their level, start by building their rapport. Create a successful and meaningful connection with both the patient and the child. So using those few minutes of play, maybe even 30 seconds to play I Spy on your badge card with a sticker that you have, is going to go a long way in building trust and help save time in the long run. Use non-threatening conversation, non-threatening language, and that creates successes. You want to talk to the child and the parent. I think it's easy for us to walk into the room and just immediately talk to the parent. Well, this is what we're going to do. But we also need to include the child in on that. Do they understand what's happening? Do they know their role? Do they know how they can be engaged? Prepare them for the experience. How can you cope with something if you don't know that it's going to happen, right? But if you do prepare for something, you practice coping skills, you are more likely to be successful. And then we have a large opportunity to build trust between you and the child. So think about sensory experiences. What is the child going to hear? What is the child going to smell? What are they going to feel? So we're going to clean your hand, but what does that mean? We're going to take a little white square that smells like alcohol. It's going to feel cold and wet when it touches your skin. So I'm preparing them for this experience, but also I am telling them exactly what it's going to feel like. Excuse me, I'm going to mute for a second. Another thing that I want to consider is that we are changing things here in the way we think about pain in children. And the old school of thought is that you need to experience a little bit of pain to be able to get through that. But research and evidence is showing us that that is actually not true, and children should not be in pain if they don't have to be. Actually having pain assists us in avoiding physical harm, but unrelieved pain may be inherently harmful both psychologically and physiologically. So a failure to intervene early in children's pain may lead to an impairment in functioning and disruption in families. Unaddressed pain heightens fear, anxiety, which in turn increases perception of pain. So it is actually more important that we think about pain before something painful happens and we address it so that the child does not have to go through pain. So the strategies that we use here in the United States are using numbing cream. So we have two different types that are we typically use called Emla and Elmex, and it's basically a topical lidocaine. It's a cream. It takes about 30 minutes to an hour to work prior to a skin breaking procedure like a poke or an injection, but it is well worth the time so that patients do not have to feel pain, especially if they're going to be poked a lot. We use the caregiver in a comforting environment. So we have the caregiver sit in the bed first, and then we have them hold the child in a loving but also safe and secure position so that we're able to provide support and also keep the caregiver close. You can use something as simple as ice to help numbing. And so then you're also before a procedure, so you're encouraging the patient to hold the ice pack themselves. Then you're empowering the patient and you're helping and thinking about pain. And then, of course, if a child is incredibly anxious and having a hard time, then we talk about what medications can we use to help reduce anxiety. So we will use intranasal midazolam in the nose or fentanyl or whatever the doctor chooses to use to help the patient calm. We do not hold children down if we are able to use medication and comfort positioning and preparation and distraction. And so it is a rule here that we do not hold children down. We use these other things. And if the child is still anxious, still combative, then we need to regroup and talk about what is the best course of action. So when you have a child that says, I'm scared," and we say, you're fine. Well, they're not fine. They're scared. They're telling you they're scared. And so we want to validate and say, you know, you do seem scared. I see what you're saying. I've seen a lot of other kids feel that way too. I can tell you're not sure what's going to happen today. Let's talk about it. We don't want to say you're fine and deny their feelings if they're not fine. So I interviewed a wonderful man named Scott for my podcast, Scott's Story, and he had a daughter who had a brain tumor. And he said the most valuable piece of experience that the child life specialist gave him was that his words had to match his daughter's experience. So if we're saying, you're fine, you know, it's just a little bump in your brain, that's actually not true. Her world right now is a whirlwind. She's getting medication. She's in the hospital. She's getting poked. She's getting prodded. If we tell her that she's fine, that's not relating to her experience. So think about that. Is what you're saying relating to the experience that they're having? Because their experience is incredibly real to them. Parents are your best ally. So getting to know the parent ahead of time, saying what works when they're stressed, what helps them when they're feeling this way, what have you noticed really is great? Can you help me figure this out? Using them in a team atmosphere is a great way to have successful outcomes. It's not great to say, oh, I know, I've done this a million times. Trust me, this is the best way to do it. Each child is unique. So you don't necessarily know the best way to treat this child in this circumstance. Having support and conversations with the parent can help you. And watch your language. I think this is such an important slide. So I've mentioned a couple things in this presentation about the stretcher, which is what we call beds on wheels, right? That's a hard word for kids to hear, stretch, or a CAT scan. CAT scan doesn't have any cats in it, right? So look at these examples here. The X-ray tech is going to come in and shoot some film. So shoot, right, is related to guns and violence. And so if he's going to come in here and shoot me is what a child is hearing. Instead, you could say my friend Carlos is going to come in to take a picture of your arm. So we're taking the language and we're adapting it to a developmentally appropriate way that kids can understand without being fearful. This medicine is kind of gross, but you'll be fine. Just drink it fast. Well, maybe instead say other kids say that if you hold your nose and drink it, it makes it way easier. So we're not telling them that it's going to be bad and that it's gross, but we're telling them a way to actually deal with it. And maybe, for example, when propofol goes into your vein, it can burn. It can feel really harmful and really hurt a lot. And instead of saying this medicine is going to burn, we can say this medicine is going to feel warm and tingly. Can you tell me what you think it feels like? So we're having them be an active participant in their care. So this is the end of the presentation. I know it was a lot of information to cover, and I just want to thank you so much and hope that you feel empowered today to use play, even if you don't have a toy with you. Just use your imagination, use I Spy. Just get to know your patients on a level that connects to them, and that will pave the way for making psychosocial care at the forefront. I also really want to encourage you to use your child life team, especially child life specialists like Tuba, that are available to you and can support you and support your families. So thank you so much for having me. You can go to my website, which is childlifepodcast.com, and you can also email me with any specific questions at katie@childlifeoncall.com. Thank you so much for having me.
Okay, so thank you, Katie. Thank you, Dion and Tara and Iram Khan, for those amazing talks. Thank you for being a part of this. I'm ready to pick your brains about, you know, specific things and the questions that have come in and the comments as well, that regarding everything that you've talked about today. I'd like to start off with talking about what Iram Khan had mentioned in talking about mental health services for specifically health care providers, chahe wo physicians ho, chahe wo anesthesiologists ho, whether they're doctors, whoever they may be, the importance of having mental health services being available to you, whether in the hospital or outside of the hospital. So one of the questions that has come up is regarding validation. And if I'm looking here and there, it's because of the questions that are available here. Validation is important. Can you elaborate on that?
Assalamu alaikum, ji. I think that's a very good question, because a lot of times in my experience, in my decade, more than a decade long experience, one of the things that I've had to constantly tell people about has been validation and how to validate, right? Mm-hmm, and the validation is... basically, you're telling your hearing. For validation, it's very important to hear what is the person saying, right? Mm-hmm. And a lot of times when we're listening to the person, we're listening with the intent of defending ourselves or answering the something or saying our piece, rather than hearing for the sake of understanding. So validation begins with understanding. What is the person trying to say? What is the person trying to get across or express, right? In short, it's saying, I hear you, right? I see that you're really frustrated. Or example, I see that you're really frustrated. I see this has really upset you. I see that you're struggling with this. It's, how shall I say? It's authenticating the other person's experience. It's saying, I believe what you're experiencing. I see what you're experiencing. And I want to understand you.
Okay, so Iram, I'd like to know, you know, having had that experience with healthcare service providers, how have you been able to see or accommodate them in that sense of letting them get validated in the experiences or helping them work through their trauma that they have experienced in their service?
This is with regard to healthcare providers. Sorry, I missed the first part. Yeah. So something that I used to do in Indus Hospital in the psychosocial oncology department was we used to have a support group. So we would sit and we would discuss our experiences, our struggles, our mistakes, and it was a no judgment space. I wasn't sitting there as a supervisor. I wasn't sitting there as somebody doing the danda. I was sitting there as somebody who was having a human to human experience with another person. We would sometimes cry. We would sometimes laugh. We would sometimes discuss things that were not part of the job, but were impacting our lives.
That's very important. Yeah.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So something that I did with my team, and I think that's very important as somebody who's leading teams, is to be able to understand your team's desires, needs, wants, long-term goals, dreams, and that's when you feel connected with the team. And that's how you connect on a level, on a human to human level. You're not, it's not that aap mere idhar meri team mein aaye hain, kaam karenge, khatam karenge aur chale jayenge. I need to know you as a person. So even during the support group, because I had that knowledge, I was able to move forward with that and create that connection with the group. And that is mentorship, frankly speaking. That is what I wanted to implement in across the board in Indus, that there needs to be mentorship across the board, not just for mental health counselors, but for all the staff, nurses, doctors, mental health counselors, every other healthcare professional, because it really helps you in times of need and distress.
I think this really relates to what you were talking about regarding burnout as well. You know, in industries or in corporations, organizations, burnout can happen really easily because it's a work, no play, no relaxation. So how would you say that this was helping them, the support group was helping them within that to, you know, sort of decrease the burnout level, to like reduce how much burnout they were experiencing?
First of all, through feedback, you ask your team, how are you feeling? How is it doing? And you ask, you know, it's like on a scale of 0 to 10, how do you feel prior to the session? How do you feel after the session? Right? Just having that feedback loop is very important. And then seeing for yourself how they're performing at work and what they're struggling with and what they're not struggling with, you can see for yourself and through observation and feedback, two things that really help.
Right?
Okay. So implementing burnout skills, something I used to also mention, and I think, I don't remember whether I did it or not, but I know we were in the process of it, was implementation of burnout skills every, you know, 4 to 6 months. It's good to do that across the board for employees, especially in a high stress situation, so that you prior to something becoming agar mild to moderate level mein aa raha hai, you can catch that at that level rather than letting it go to a level of severity.
That's actually exactly, that's a very good point that you raised here, because it's very easy for it to like go across the board, or agar hum level 4 pe hain, toh easily we can go to level 10 and without catching it. And then we've skipped that opportunity of being able to reduce the burnout when we could have done it very effectively, as opposed to at level 10.
Absolutely. The other thing that I used to do with my team was also I would ask them, how are you going to unwind today? Are you going to stop responding after 5 p.m.? Because I don't need you to respond after this time. That is your time. So striking that work-life balance. And I would also usually ask, what are you doing over the weekend? So it was not just sirf weekend pe aapne unwind karna hai, but on a daily basis and over the weekend. So it has to have that consistency in caring for the team and in creating and inculcating an environment of care.
Also, there is a question here from one of our speakers. They're asking, as providers, where we may not also mindfully practice compassionate exercises, how would you suggest us starting to being consistent in this area?
I'm trying to understand the question. Well, we may not also mindfully practice compassion. It's not really that difficult. As I said, even from going from one ward to the next, I had made it a point I would just breathe during that time. Right? I've done mindful exercises sitting in a rickshaw with the dhar going on. Right? The thing is, the more you do something, the more power you give it. It's like a ritual. Right? Usually I tell people ke aapko 10 ghante, hum log 1 ghante, एक से डेढ़ घंटे के हम लोग ब्रीदिंग एक्सरसाइज
इन इंग्लिश प्लीज डॉक्टर खान.
सो यूजुअली व्हाट वी यूज्ड टू डू, आई वेंट थ्रू अ प्रोग्राम वेयर वी जस्ट ब्रीद फॉर वन एंड अ हाफ आवर, जस्ट माइंडफुल ब्रीदिंग. राइट? सो व्हेन आई टेल पीपल हु आर न्यू टू दिस, आई टेल देम स्टार्ट विद जस्ट 10 सेकंड्स, स्टार्ट विद जस्ट 3 ब्रेथ्स एंड देन ब्रिंग इट अप. यू कैन ब्रीद, व्हाइल ब्रीदिंग इज द वन थिंग दैट यू कैन डू एट एनी पॉइंट इन टाइम.
And if I may, I think one thing that can, you know, they're mentioning mindful practice, not being able to do mindful practice, they can set reminders, put it in their to-do notes.
Absolutely, so that they can have that constant. And also set a certain time. When you set a certain time, then aapka, taking it forward from what you were saying, I think that's a great point. Is that setting those reminders, making it into a routine, when it becomes a ritualized practice, it becomes habit.
Yes.
Initially, it's a struggle. It may be a struggle, maybe forming groups. Mm-hmm. Something I used to tell the nurses also, as soon as you come into the hospital, just take that moment when you're changing into your hospital clothes to just breathe. Doesn't take very long, doesn't take a lot of effort. And there is a particular theory called polyvagal theory, which talks about the power of breath to reduce the trauma response in the system.
Thank you so much. I have one more question for you. And that is, self-awareness, I know, can be very difficult for a lot of people, especially doctors when they've, or, you know, physicians, anybody, because they've had to be on their feet so constantly, nurses. So it's like their body is in automation. Their reflexes are automatic. Okay, you know, I need to do this. I need to get this done, this done, this done. So in that sense, how can we come towards acceptance of self-related issues when we're so used to being in automatic mode?
Absolutely. So when the time that you get, that is your unwinding time, take those moments. I've used the bathroom also for that. Take a loo break, and using mindfulness when you're washing your hands, just focus on the soap, the water, and the water on your skin. That in it, I mean, this is so simple. This is so simple and so wonderful. It really pays you back, right? Just the act of, you know, we're big foodies in Pakistan. We love our food. When you're eating, just being focused on the food. Just being focused on the food, even if it's for 5 minutes. I'm eating this. How does it taste like? How is the texture? How's the taste? How's the smell? Especially if you're eating good food, right? Just enjoying that experience of those 5 minutes that you've taken away. That's what mindful is, being in the moment.
For sure. When we're talking about self-acceptance, there was this part in your presentation when you mentioned being able to apologize, being able to accept mistakes, being able to, you know, be okay with disappointing sometimes. So do you think that that is also related with self-acceptance?
Absolutely. Acceptance is this acceptance. Self-acceptance is when we accept our fallibility, that we are flawed to begin with. We're not perfect. We are perfect in our imperfection, is something I say, right?
Yes.
We are perfect in our imperfections, and that's beautiful. That's absolutely fine, because that's what makes us unique. Being able to disappoint, my children usually make fun of me when they say, okay, mom, we love this, what you say, that it's okay to disappoint. It's okay to disappoint your parents as well. I'm okay. I can tolerate that. As parents, sometimes, you know, as children sometimes feel they can't disappoint their parents, but they forget that we're not really that fragile. We can take that disappointment. And the same way, the organization can take some disappointment at times as well. Your supervisor can take some disappointment at times as well. This is specifically for those who are constantly striving for perfection. I have got to do everything right. I've got to make sure that I've done not 100, but 110%.
Because I think, sorry.
Go on.
Sorry, I was just saying this sort of comes with the territory when you're in a healthcare profession, for doctors, ICU doctors, ER doctors.
Absolutely. And people may find this strange, but I say, you know, some people will live and some people will die. Some people will suffer a lot, and some people will suffer less. Everybody has their journey. Acceptance of that as well. Something my professor had said, you cannot cure everybody, you cannot treat everybody, that is their journey, but you can provide support through that journey. And one of the most difficult things you can do sometimes is, you know, we find it very difficult when a loved one is in pain and we want to fix it. And I'm like, it is their journey. You can only do so much, right? Because then we force the other person to do things that they don't want to do. We become mm-hmm. brutal and cruel. So understanding that everybody has their journey, not everybody is supposed to live a very long life. Our job was to provide options, opportunities, choices. I remember wow. there was a psychiatrist who had come in from abroad, and I remember him turning, psychiatrist or oncologist, who had, and he turned and he asked us, do you give a choice? Do you give choice to your patients to take the treatment or not? Mm-hmm. To live or not to live?
Yeah, right, right. So that's the choices it. And everything, there's a journey for every person involved.
Absolutely, absolutely. Yeah.
So thank you so much, Dr. Khan, Dr. Iram. I loved everything about your presentation. Sometimes we really need a reiteration of self-care. We really need an understanding of all of those things regarding our life and our choices and the choices that we are also able to provide people. I'd like to move to asking Dion and Tara, who are here with us, questions regarding their presentation as well, because they also mentioned self-care. They also reiterated on those points. And so I have a question for Dion. You mentioned psychosocial assessments. What are some of the ways you are able to assist parents after getting that information? Is there any case example that you can share with us?
Thank you so much. I just want to clarify that I understood the question correctly. Can you say it again, please?
What are some of the ways you are able to assist parents after getting the assessment information? And do you have any case example that you can share with us?
Yes. So, once we complete our assessment, it really helps us understand what are the needs of the families. In one example that of one case that I worked with, this was a teenage adolescent patient who was suffering with an eating disorder. And with this particular family, through my assessment, I learned that for young people who are struggling with eating disorders, for example, it's really important for the family, the parents, the caregivers to be involved in helping their recovery process. And in this particular example, the mother herself had a history of eating disorder, and she was finding it very difficult to support her daughter because she mm-hmm. was being triggered by trying to help her child recover and eat. And as we know with eating disorders, it is a psychological illness as well. The treatment is medication, but for young kids, it really involves the family taking an active role in making sure that the young person receives sufficient nourishment and treatment. So with this mommy, what I ended up doing was I did more family-based interventions, but I also took time to work with mom separately to understand her triggers and help her develop skills to minimize the triggers so she can still be present. So one very tangible technique that I did was separating meal times. So usually meal times are encouraged for them to have meals together, but because of mommy's own trigger, the mm-hmm. meal times were not being effective because they were comparing each other's intake. So what I ended up doing was having mommy still be present for family meal times, but her meal times were a bit separate. So she would have meal time maybe with just dad or maybe with just one of the other siblings until she was able to tolerate those family meals together. The other thing that I felt was important was to connect her with our other mental health support team, where mom's individual mental health needs around her eating could be prioritized so that when she did come to engage in our clinical sessions, it was focused specifically on her daughter, on her child. The outcome of the situation is as mom developed her own coping and was able to process and regain control over her eating habits and use some of the techniques that she had known and developed from a younger age, she was better able to be more engaged in her daughter's care with time. As a psychosocial clinicians, it's really important after assessments for us to be able to evaluate and reevaluate when interventions are not working. So in a typical eating disorder model, we would do more family-based intervention, but in this particular case, the family-based intervention was not as effective given mom's own history. Mm-hmm. So at that point, as a clinician, I needed to be willing to adjust the plans, adjust the treatment modality in order to not just meet the needs of the young person, but also meet the needs of the mother in this particular case.
That sounds like, I feel like that must have taken quite a bit of time to help the mother engage with the patient and her own child's healthcare treatment plan. I think that that is amazing, you know, the work that you guys are doing there with the parents, involving them in the child's care and the treatment plan as well. Is there anything that you utilize to set up session plans for parents and family sessions?
Mm-hmm. Yes, indeed. So when we create treatment planning from a social work perspective, it's very important to have the family engaged in the treatment planning. Because if they don't have buy-in with the work that's being done, then you have a lack of engagement, right? So usually after we complete our assessment, we will formulate what we think is going on with the family. And that formulation is shared with the family. Because mm-hmm. once the formulation is shared, that then is the premise where we build our treatment planning. And part of within the first or second session, we share this treatment plan or intervention plans with the family. We reiterate the fact that it's going to be hard work, you know, trying to work on some of the mental health challenges that families experience. There are times in which it's so overwhelming and difficult for them. They may be tempted to miss sessions or not engaged. So usually when I treat, I have that conversation up front. I let them know it's going to be difficult work. There are times that you don't want to come to your sessions. There are going to be times in which it gets painful, but it's so important for us to work through those challenging times because the end result is going to be even more fulfilling. So I acknowledge it at the beginning. I talk about how we're going to work through it at the beginning, which sets the stage for when it does happen, because it does. I'm able to remind them, hey, do you remember when we talk about it being challenging? Well, now is one of those times in which we need to go deeper. And it's going to be a little bit painful, but I'm here to help support you through this process. So we do share the plan with them. Mm-hmm. And as the plan changes, we also engage them. So before we check off a goal or complete a particular intervention, we will revisit it with the family and say, hey, in this area, do you feel there's more work for us to do, or are you comfortable with us moving on to the next area? So it's they're buying in to the stages of treatment, and you want to keep them engaged because that is how they are able to mark their own progress. That's how they stay motivated, and that's how they're able to remain engaged in care.
Okay, that sounds great, and that sounds like a very comprehensive plan that you at Sidra are providing to the parents and the patients as well. I have a question here for Tara as well. Tara, can you tell me, you know, as Dion just mentioned that, you know, some of the challenges that the parents are facing, you guys acknowledged that in the beginning. So I have a question regarding those challenges. So when you face them with the parents, what do you utilize to cater to those challenges with the parents?
The challenges around the parents' own mental health difficulties or the blockades they might encounter during their hospital journey?
Yeah, sometimes, you know, when they're not willing to engage in the healthcare journey, when they're, you know, willing, maybe they're, as Dion said, they might be tempted to miss sessions, tempted to not engage as much as they would, we would want them to, specifically within the child's treatment journey. So how do you motivate them, maybe? How do you engage them as much? Like, you know, Dion said, you give them the control, but what else do you guys use?
So I would say, in order to get the best quality of work out of parents, the first step is to create a very solid relationship with them, your rapport. That is going to see you through a lot of the difficulties that you encounter. If families trust you, they can share with you their experiences. They feel like you're, I think one of the most important things you need to bring to this is this idea of active listening. So it's about being present with them where they are, being non-judgmental, showing care, showing to them that what their child is experiencing, it's the child's illness, but it is impacting them as parents, as caregivers, in their relationships with themselves, with others, giving them that empathy, that trust, that they need to really engage with you. So that is the first step. If you get that right, you're going to have a much more streamlined process going ahead, because there's not going to be that resistance to engage. Of course, that may still you may still encounter that. And I had that yesterday. So I can speak to an example from yesterday of a young person who I'm working with, who is under our mental health clinic. And so the young person has a diagnosis of conversion disorder. But that impacts the parents, because the parents now, with as with any illness, whether it be a physical illness, a mental health illness, either inpatient or outpatient, once a child is ill, the family has to reorganize itself around that illness. So you're talking about school runs and work and other children. Everything has to shift into to now figure out a new way of working with the illness. So for this family in particular, mom is struggling because she can't leave the child alone. And as she views that the child's, her view, what she was presenting to me, is that nothing's improving, the child is staying the same. So then my job as the clinician is to look for the exceptions to that. So you're telling me nothing's the same, but at the same time, you're telling me that you've noticed some improvements in the relationships that she's having with her peers, that she's having with her father. So it's about looking for the exceptions, reframing, and then again, instilling confidence in the parents that you're not alone here, that we're here, we're a team, and we have a shared goal. And then challenging and reflecting on some of the barriers we might incur is where parents say, this isn't working. And at that time, you have to go back to, well, why isn't it working? That's the evaluation Dion spoke about. And there might be many reasons why it isn't working. But as the clinician, you have to explore that with them and find out, what are the barriers? What are the boundaries? Is the resistance coming from you as the parent? Is the resistance coming from the community? Is it from the stigma? Or is it from the physical barriers to getting to your appointments? Where is the resistance coming from? And what that you can break down the problems for the parents.
Okay.
If I may, I just want to just add something to that as well.
I would just like to add before we go, I know that we have a small time, you know, frame for the question and answers. So I would like you to just put in what you'd like to say, and then we'd move towards the closing as well.
Sure, just one statement. There are times in which you get to a point in treatment where the family may require a change in treatment focus. So sometimes when you hit that resistance, you may ask the family, what would you like us to focus on now? And maybe if we're able to meet their needs with whatever they see as pressing in that particular moment, allows us to open the door for us to continue with the treatment planning. So their focus may shift because there's something else that's preoccupying their minds. And as clinicians, we need to also be able to move with them as their mm-hmm. needs change.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Thank you. That was very, very insightful, Dion and Tara. Thank you so much for your time. Thank you, Iram and Katie, for your time as well and giving us, you know, an inside look into all of your expertise and your experience. I hope you two, all of you were able to, enjoy here talking about what you do here and giving us a, you know, in-depth look into what you do as well. Take care. We're going to take our leave. Thank you.